Right, welcome to this episode. Light shining through the edge of the barn there. Right, welcome to this episode of Southpaw Restoration, as sponsored by Church House Classics. I'll do a video on who Church House Classics are, but it's basically me, my little company that I set up, limited company that I set up, and I'll do a little presentation about Church House Classics on this channel, about who we are and what we do. Now, in this episode, episode 5 I think it is, correct me if I'm wrong, really it's about putting the back axle back on the car. It's about sorting a bit of welding out on the front inner wings. It's about really just moving the project forwards rather than tearing things apart and moaning like hell about wear and tear on a 29-year-old car. It's about actually doing something and putting things back together again. So this project's turning much more positive every single episode. I hope you can see that. I am enjoying it. It's great fun. So please enjoy, please subscribe if you like this kind of material, please offer feedback, please hit the old like, thumbs up, or even the thumbs down button if you must. But yeah, I do these things because I enjoy sharing the information on what's required of these projects. And really, just to show that they are only machines, they're not to be feared. There's no reason to be scared of these things, it's just a machine. Built by man, built by mere mortals. Even those in Solihull are mere mortals. Please enjoy. Thank you for watching. Axle parts order hasn't turned up today, so axle's still on the floor. Can't do anything with that. So I've started on the front near wings. I had kind of just bolted wings up. It took me minutes to remove all those off again, just really stuck them on while it went out into the field. Now, I've cleaned all the paint off this... this top rail from the inner wing. It's not structural, but it does support the wing. And there is a fair amount of crumbliness going on here. And I think what I'm going to do... Found a few more holes. Bugger. Yes. This is the new passenger side. Someone's been really creative with the filler on this side. Really creative. Might be easy just to replace this box section. I've done the whole thing. There's less holeage going on at the front than there is in the middle section. There's very, very little on the underside. That's all quite nice under there, but again, skimmed with filler. This stuff under here, I did attack it and it is really sticky, so I'm going to probably leave this heavy duty sealant on here because it's clean metal underneath. Under here it's probably just its original finish, but this area here, in fact, is that a hole there? No, it isn't. My finger's behind that black scar thing. Right, we know where the enemy is. The more I chopped, the more I thought, you know what, just fucking have the thing off, fed up with it. The patch that was on the outside there had been welded over rusty metal. Okay, cut a little bit of the middle of it out, but it's all rusty on the edges. So that's coming out. It's uncovered a hole through the bottom there. The thing is absolutely full of sand or dirt or something. It's been doing some proper deep wading, this car, I tell you. That's probably why this box section's rotted out. Because it doesn't get the air going through it. Because the wing's in the way, and that's probably why it has started to rot out, but it's full of mud. I've still got this section at the front here to chop out. What I'm going to end up doing, I think, is probably, there's a very fine line here in between replacing this whole box section and the side section, which I could probably just put sheet steel into. But then do I also then replace the arch section, which the only problem with the arch section is it's got lots of holes in it, drilled holes rather than rusty holes like this shit. I'm going to leave the front and back sections in place because they are relatively solid. These bits here, I've been over them with a centre punch and they're pretty solid. I can certainly plug weld those holes up. That bit there was a bit too far gone. As I was punching it, it was denting it quite badly. You can see where I've hit that with the centre punch. And this, nowhere near as bad. So there's still some structure in that metal layer. That piece I'm going to just weld a patch over. That's not a problem there. Leave this box section, leave that box section. I know where to make up my connection then. But anyway, it is what it is. It ain't what it ain't. Right, so that worked out quite nicely, actually. Got the flat piece of steel on the top here, and apart from the two ends, which I kind of put a few dobs on, might put a slug on that end, the rest of it is done on the inside. Not particularly tidy, because it was difficult to clean up this original metal. But it's good enough. It's good enough, and it's strong again. So I need to make a box section up now. Sorry, make an L zigzag section. I don't know. Make up a section to cover that over now. There it is, with somewhat triumphant music. Done that piece, welded those plugs in. The only mild disaster was the metal was too thin here to weld onto. So rather than just make a complete hash of it, I'm going to extend this hole up to this piece. It's not going to be a problem. I'm not going to cut it today, though. I'm going to cut it tomorrow, because I've got a strict rule about operating the angle grinder after 6 o'clock. And that's mainly because I don't want sparks in the garage unattended. But yeah, that's... responding well to the hammer of testing. Oh, it's done most of that. The only thing I will need to do is I need to drill holes, but what I'll end up doing, rather than putting the captives in, I'll probably just drill a hole where the fucking thing's going to need to go and put a self-tapper in. That'll do the job then. I have found you can actually get this this L section, or this zigzag section. You can buy it. It's about £3, but it's £10 a postage. And I've used about £2 worth of steel here. Trouble is, it's taken me a couple of hours really to do this whole side. And I haven't quite finished this whole side yet, because I've got this little bastard bit of res to do, but that should be relatively straightforward. Just cut a piece of steel. In fact, I'll do that tonight. Cut a piece of steel to go into there, and I'll just weld that in tomorrow morning. And tidy these welds up now! Woohoo! Pleased with that. Oh, I didn't do that. Let me do that next. You've got to love it when a nice big bag of hairy, shiny new bolts arrives. Look at these. A-frame to chassis. Link to axle. Link to chassis. And these are the link bracket to chassis. Nice and shiny. Look at that lot. Right, okay. I'm going to get these spring cups back on, first of all. So we have done a wee welding job on the bottom of that. I've got the bolts already. I shall lube up the bolts because they're a little bit distressed. I'm not going to worry too much about them. As long as they're lubed, they'll go in. And then pop these fellers on. And put the link arms on. And then shift the axle underneath the car. What I'm going to have to do, I think, though, is support the exhaust somehow, because the exhaust has dropped down off its mount. So let me have a look at that as well. Symphony in blue poly bushes. These are the link arms that connect up to the chassis, and these are the A-frame arms, all ready to go back on it together. You also would have noticed from that time-lapse video that the position the car was located, there's no way was the... this. I mean, okay, this is a shortened spring, but with the axle at the full extent of the damper, there was about 3 inches of play on the spring. So the spring had no force whatsoever on the axle. And the axle was quite happy to hang off the A-frame and its link rods. So those 2-inch lifts, I know it's my own stupid fault, and I know I should have had a jack underneath the diff on this side. And I don't quite know why I didn't do that. I've watched the video back a couple of times, which I haven't published, for obvious reasons, gratuitous gore and so forth, I just don't understand how I managed to do it. But I'll tell you one thing, when I undid that damper bolt down there and I had the disc on, it was the disc that hit the back of my finger. And it came down with some force. It really did. In fact, you can see down here, that is the mark the disc made on the floor when it came down. Today's target, the target of today, achieved. Woohoo! Rear axle's in place, all torqued up. I've got the springs, dampers, discs, hubs, all sorted out. New calipers, both sides. It's been a wedge of work. Largely just assembling stuff, but it's heavy duty. When you're on your own, it's been about, I suppose, 6 hours work to get it from it all being its component parts to actually being on the car. I think that's pretty respectable, actually. Yeah, I'm pleased. So really I need the Bosch self-leveling strut before I go too much further on the back end, because I need to drop the axle down quite a long way in order, not beyond where the dampers go, but I need to drop the axle down a fair way, which is why I've still got the axle stand underneath the body, as well as axle stands under the axle. And he fell over then. And then I can mount the Bosch self-leveling strut onto that little knob that's sticking up there. And that then will finish that. I managed to pull this dent out on this wing. Look at that. Quite pleased with that as well. Still think this was past it. It's amazing, isn't it? This is 1990, this car. And the gaps haven't got any better. And I can't show you the gap between the front wing and the deck, but I'd imagine it's going to be exactly the same as that 1972 car I built. And this really is Solihull saying, do you know what? We got it right the first time round. And I genuinely do believe the two-door Range Rover is one of the prettiest off-roaders there has ever been. Ever. Just my humble opinion, but ever. And they've never improved on this design. And they've blinged it all up by putting rubbing strips and all sorts of other stuff all over it for CSKs, and they've blinged it up with leather. But it's never, ever got past the purity and the balance of the shape of the original two-door Range Rover. That's why I like them so much. Right. Today, finally going to get on with this bloody door hinge. So, the issue with the door hinge, let me open the door slightly, is this top hinge has got a significant amount of play. If I hold the camera there, the pin's knackered. So, the pin is more likely to have gone than the actual hinge itself. The hinge is cast, and the pin is probably just mild steel pin that's been drifted through. I will get the hinge off. It has been removed quite recently. The bolts and fixings look quite good. Really, all I do is open the door. I'll support it on a block of wood on the trolley jack. The trolley jack's got a soft pad on it anyway. I don't want to cause any damage to the bottom of the door. Support the door. Remove the old hinge. I've painted a new hinge, all ready to go on. Which is... Look at that. Along with the strobing light. So we'll put that on. I will set it up with the shims as it stands at the moment. Now, looking at this puppy, might need a bit of light in here for this. There is no shims at the A-post end, and it looks like just one shim at the door end, which is unusual. Now, basically, these doors, the idea is when the door closes, it does close a little bit down. Why is that so foggy? It's because of the light above. Let's do it like that. It does close quite close to the B post. But then the lock pin works on the ramp at the bottom of that and does lift the door as it opens. And the idea behind this is it's a heavy old door. And really, when you pull the lever, you want it to swing open. So that's the idea behind the doors on these things. But as you can see, it doesn't close particularly well. And also there's evidence of the top of the window frame clouting the B-post, which is not good, really. So yeah, we're going to change this hinge up. There we are. Okay, I've got a relatively even gap up the front of the door. I've got a massive gap down the back of the door. And I've got an inconsistent gap down the closing face. But it opens and it closes with a slam. What I'm going to do next, I'm going to put a shim behind the door face of the hinge. I'm just going to get all my shims out now. When you put your shims in here, it's best to loosen the bolts on the outside of the door as well, at both ends, because the thing will need to move around, if you get my drift. The other thing that's irritating me, glass frame's all loose, and also there's, I think what I'm going to do is get this door done properly. I am going to remove the frame, because it's largely out anyway. There's the wrong screw holding it in there, and nothing holding it in there. Let me pull this frame out, because it's literally just a minute or two. So it's closed there onto the first catch quite easily. Firmer hand, and it closes up flush, but I'm just not happy with that panel gap, which starts out more than a finger width and tightens up to a fingertip down at the bottom here. As you go up, it gets wider. And obviously the same is replicated with the glass channel. It gets slightly tighter as it gets down towards the bottom. Now there's a certain amount of movement in the glass frame itself. So really what I want to do next, I think, is move this whole door back. Get my drift? And slightly pivot it off the top, so it's going to go back and slightly down, and then I can adjust the door up to close the gap at the back end. Anyway, what I'm having to do here, the problem I've got now is that I couldn't work out what the fuck was going on. The best thing to do is to start back at a baseline. I'm going to have to change the bolts at the bottom because they're not the right type of bolts, i.e. they're bloody great big. Yes, not great, is it? And they should look like that, flathead there, or even a... They come with various different styles, but also come with this style, you see. I'm going to replace the bolts. I'm going to put shims in between, or in behind these gaskets that go to the bulkhead. The reason being is the door at the moment is too far forwards. So if I put a couple of shims in there, I'm really talking that much sort of thickness, on top and bottom, and then I can, once I get the door roughly right backwards and forwards, then I can start pissing around with it on the upwards and downwards kind of plane. So I am going to crack on with this. You can watch if you want. I don't mind. So what have you just seen? Right, okay, I took all the shims out and got a baseline. Then what I did was put in enough shims between the A-post and the A-post side of the hinge to move the door backwards. So the door then kind of narrowed the gap here. Then what I did was added shims behind the door edge of the hinge to level it up and even the gap. And fucking check that out. Oh, famous last words, eh? I'd say that'll do. That's not bad, is it? I just need to get these handles blasted back, paint them black. I could powder coat them black, in fact. I don't know why you would paint them white. It's a bit Barbie, that, isn't it? Anyway, we'll do that, but glass frame can go in next, but when I pulled the door frame out, we've got a little bit of corrosion down here. Nothing serious, but I do want to kind of clean it up a little bit and see what's going on there. and make sure it's not going to get any worse. Because while the frame's out, I know it only takes me 10 minutes to get the bloody frame out, but while it's out, I might as well get this thing sorted out properly. So that's the new passenger side hinge done. And I've loosely fitted the wing. I know the gap's tighter on the wing than it is on the door, but it's a fucking Range Rover, for God's sake. No, I shouldn't say that. It's a fucking Land Rover. Range Rovers these days are not Land Rovers, are they? Let's face it. This Range Rover comes complete with no computers. Quite why you'd need... Look at the lines on those doors. I know I'm a bit anal about all this. It's a habit of mine, I'm afraid. I'm sorry about that. I haven't got the wing on this side. But this door, it opens and closes just as nicely. I haven't done anything with this one at all. This is pretty much as it came out of the box. And that one on the other side will sound a lot less tinny when I secure the window framing, which wasn't secured in at all. I must say, there was like one loose bolt holding the whole damn thing in. Which is why I decided to take it right out. Yeah, I'm pleased enough with that. Done that bit, welded on quite nicely, butted it up to the original part. Happy enough with that. Started digging into this little bit beside the battery tray, and it just got bigger. So what looked as a fairly kind of little hole that I might have been able to just plug up ended up being quite a large hole. Very, very, very thin metal all around this area. And then obviously I found the hole in the bottom panel, which I'm going to need to weld up as well. Ended up having to cut another chunk of this wing out, which is a bit disappointing. I should have gone over the whole freaking thing. And now I can see, having cleaned all the bottom up here, there's a big old welded patch at the bottom here. So perhaps I might have been better off just replacing this whole section. Fuck's sake. Anyway, hindsight's a marvellous thing. But it's solid again. Once that's got, I've been zinc priming around and about as well. Going to get this side done next, I think. And it could end up being... I think, to be honest, there's a couple of holes there. Most of the holes are up this end here. And again, box section related. Right, spin straightening all of these various dents and things out on this inner door frame. Got the majority, that's a big one there, I need to push that in. Got the majority of them out and tidied it all up. I think it's a much earlier door shell because they've had to cut it out to accommodate the later style of lock, which has then broken. So I'm going to weld that in again. And the other thing is the window regulator. It's for a manual window regulator, not the electric ones. One thing I have noticed, by the way, Tim, you've got a bloody great big scuff on the passenger side of your windscreen, which I'm going to have to work out how we're going to polish that out. It's from a... I mean, it's one on this side as well, but it's from knackered blades or from... It's either knackered blades or just a mixture of sand and off-roading. I don't really want to start pissing around changing windscreens unless we absolutely have to. I'm going to see if I can polish this out. There's a fair few... chips on the screen, but nothing serious. I'll look into some of the polishing kits. There's some welding splatter on this. There's some sparks here. I was careful.
I had the blanket at the top.
We'll see what we can do with the screen. This is all done. Quite a lot of welding on there in the end. For this side, I'm going to cut pretty much the whole fucking box section off from about there up to about here. I just weld in a complete new section because I've been along it with the hammer. If I use my hammer of testing, I've just got a nasty pointy end on the end of it, and just under gravity, very soft metal. If you do it on that, it doesn't mark it. Do it on this, and it's denting it. Doesn't mark over there. So, I think pretty much this whole fucking thing, you see how much that's moving there. Otherwise, I'm going to end up getting into the same ball's ache that I went on with that side, it just becomes a complete and utter clusterfuck. And the more you end up cutting out, the more you end up having to, I don't know, pain in the ass. Anyway, what I might have to do is get these brake lines out of the way first of all, which is no huge deal, because there's no fluid in the system yet. And then I may need to replace this inner section here. Now all along, let's go the right way up. All along this inner section here, I'm happy with all of this. Up here, they're very soft. You can hear the change in the tone as it goes towards some really soft metal. That down there is tough, because I've welded it all on this side. But all along here, soft. Right, so this front wing, I've ended up cutting a fair chunk of it out. Wherever there was rust, it's been eradicated. I've left this step in because that's actually not a bad place to start from, and it's solid. I've cut out a chunk of the side of the bulkhead because it's festering. I'm going to take this little piece out down here, and then I'm going to make up a new piece that goes all the way down to the bottom. And I may then cut out this whole triangular section here and right way down to there, and just buy the repair panel or use a big lump of flat steel. I don't know yet. It's neither shit nor apples. I think the repair panel's about £8 and I'll probably use about £6 worth of steel, but it just saves me cutting it all out. It's a good job I didn't sort all these out to get them all really, really beautiful, because I'm going to have to straighten those out later on. Right, that's got the bulkhead side back together in one piece. I welded in a plate on the inside because I wasn't quite sure where this rail is going to need to be, and it will probably need to be flush with the inner wing anyway to stop water getting in behind it from above. There's going to be a lot of seam sealer on here, I think. And this edge was a great success, I think. There's a couple of bits, just a little bit of heat getting to it. That's better. A little bit of heat got in there, big old dent there. There we are, that'll do it. Right, let's get on with this door now. Welded this little strip on the top here. Not beautiful, but it does the job. Got the electrics back in, so that's the electrics for the mirror, and the electrics for the window lift. Two connectors now rather than four. We don't need the connectors for the central locking, nor do we need the connector for the speaker. And it was all mangled up anyway. Right, door closes, door locks on the inside, door doesn't open, door unlocks on the inside, door opens. Inside catch, works, door locked, inside catch, don't work, door unlocked, opened. Right, start putting this door back together again now. Can't finish this door off because I haven't got the 8mm bolts, M6 bolts, to secure the bottom of the frame, but it's all in. I've got the electrics in there, so two connectors now go to this door. The white one is for the electric windows, and the black and gold one is for the electric mirrors. For which, you notice how nicely that closes? For which the connector is up here. Okay, that's that one. This side. Right, okay, take the mirror off it. And I pulled all the loom out, because it's all a bit of a shambles, actually, on this side. And I think I found out why the electric mirrors weren't working on this side. And that's because all the cables have been cut. And also, the electric mirror on this side has got a different connector to it. So I need to work out how I'm going to connect the mirror back up again. But I'm not going to use this unit anyway, because it's got cracks and beaten up bits all over it. So the other thing I found that's amusing me on this, I'll just balance my camera down here. That's fairly typical of the wiring that I've been finding inside this thing. It's been trapped in something, hasn't it? Big time. I just all crimped it all up. So I'm going to strip out the wiring I don't need. Not interested in a lot of the wiring for this. I don't know what the blue and yellow one is. I'll just take it out and leave it intact. Two wires. Probably for something like a light on the door. But I don't think there is lights on these doors. I think they've just got reflectors on them. I have just got reflectors, there's no light. Paint's arrived, which is good news. I'm going to paint all of this in a wing tomorrow. I'm going to get all the brake lines and stuff out of the way so I can just lube it the fuck up. And paint all of these, get this whole side put together then, once the paint's all dried off. And then the Loom situation. I bought a 1993 Range Rover, complete Loom, 1993 with a 200 TDI. And I'm going to have to make it work. It will work. I'll find a way of making it work. It's going to work. I have actually got two complete body looms. Three, including this one. So this is the earlier connectors for the rear end. And then the other half is over there. I've started pulling all this apart because I've got crazy things like I don't know what this black tube is for. No idea on that. And then I've got the pipe, the tube for the rear wash wipe, which we'll need to move to the other side. So I'm going to need to drop the headlining down a little bit in order to access the loom as it goes over the top. I'm not going to bother doing that until the loom actually arrives. What I'm going to do now, though, is sort this door loom out. So the ones I want to keep are the grey, the two grey ones. They go to the electric window. I'm going to tidy up that connection there. And then I need to work out what it is I need to do for the mirror. In fact, something here has been very on fire. That's been properly on fire, hasn't it? Yes, I think we'll abandon that. I'll see if I can get another door loom for the mirrors. It wouldn't be a problem. We'll be able to do that. It's not the end of the world. It would be nice to get it in, though. I'm not taking the frame out on this side because I think I can work around it. Yes. Joy. Deep joy.